So we do market making, statistical arbitrage, and directional mean reversion and trend following. Four kinds of strategies. Well, you can call liquidity mining a fifth kind of strategy because it's not the same as market making. So on directional side, it requires very little like mass. Well, you need some Kalman filters and stuff, but it's for experienced people, it's very easy. Yep. So you do need a model to model the spread and stuff, but then you can just plot a line where you want to execute it and it more or less works. So it's very visual and it's not complicated. But what you need is to understand how to see the opportunities where it will work. Because if you just go and launch mean reversion trading on BTC USDT, it will kill you in a day, like with our speed. So it does nothing. So you need to find like either markets or combinations of markets if you want to do like a stat urban portfolio or something, where the relationships exist that are conducive to what you try to execute. Mm-hmm. So it's more of like finding things that work in the way that are convenient for your strategies than the other way around.
Right, right.
Yeah. Same with trend following. It works if you find markets that trend.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So yeah. If you trade like euro, I don't know, then it doesn't work very well.
Yeah.
Same goes for market making. Basically, like, the less volatile the market is, the more volume there is, the easier it is to make. Mm-hmm. So if you just go and launch pure market making strat on BTC USD again, it will kill you very fast. Because
yeah.
The volatility is just huge. Unless you do something to it, right? You can start mm-hmm. thinking about it, okay, maybe I want to like try and catch those waves like it mm-hmm. goes in. It might work, but it's not pure MM on the top of the book, right? As you said again, right, you can try and find like relationship-based opportunities. Like you can try and find exchanges which will pay you for trading. Mm-hmm. Like some of them subsidize their market makers, some provide rebates,
yeah.
Some just give you like zero fees and you can execute mm-hmm. limit orders if you can. And I would say that liquidity mining programs that you guys run is actually that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It's like a subsidized trading.
Yeah.
Because of that, it's a lot easier to provide liquidity in these markets because you can even trade it at a small loss, but it's still paid for from liquidity. Yeah.
In general, I think my general advice for individual users is that look for opportunities where you're getting paid to trade. You know, so it's kind of like, whether it's for rebates, liquidity mining, you know, lower fees, whatever. But basically, I think what's happening in the market is, you know, for like the big players in the market, like the big hedge funds, are always going to have a huge advantage over the small players on the biggest markets, like Binance. You know, Binance, yeah. USDT, BTC, USDT, and Binance is going to be a really competitive market with all the big whales there.
It's a future special. Yeah.
And, so, and plus, like, you know, but and also those whales are trading with zero, basically not paying any fees. You know, because they're like very high VIP level.
No, they're getting rebates.
Yeah, they're getting rebates too. So it's like, where do small players have an advantage? It's really at the smaller exchanges, where they're willing to give you rebates, like smaller trading pairs, they're giving you like liquidity mining rewards. And so it's kind of like, for the big players, it's harder for them to trade on those smaller venues and be a smaller markets because they have too much money.
No liquidity.
Yeah, no liquidity. And so mm-hmm. that's kind of why there's a liquidity reward there. But that's kind of also why, like, for the smaller players, you want to play in those smaller ponds. You know, if yes. small fish go in smaller ponds and earn the rewards that help you kind of compensate for the risk of trading.
Yeah, that definitely helps.
Well, so we want to be like, can you tell me, like, how big is 3J now in terms of like people or AUM or like how big?
So there is no AUM. It's a prop shop.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
It's, we trade our own capital. Mm-hmm. Which we don't really want to disclose.
Sure.
In terms of people, it's a small team. The size varies a bit, but it's around like 5 people.
Okay.
We've been like, the smallest we've been is like 3, and the biggest we've been is like 12. Okay.
Do you center how much volume you're doing on like a monthly basis?
So last time I checked, we did about like $1 billion on Binance.
Okay.
Last month.
That's pretty big.
It depends a lot on what kind of strategies you trade. If like this month you traded like StatArp and MinRef, it's gonna be not a lot because there is not a lot of trading going on. Like some StatArp trade can last days, and if you just do like pure market making on the top, it's a lot more volume.
Right.
Yeah. So it depends. Yeah.
So how did you get involved with Hummingbot?
I think it was after we realized that machine learning, like applying it directly to trading, doesn't work very well. Actually, I think it was a funny story. I went on vacation, I think, for a month, and I said, okay, like, I'm fed up with this stuff. Let me rest. And my co-founder, actually, he's like, okay, I'll try something different. And he does most of the technical stuff. So he doesn't do the research, but he does a lot of the software things, like the execution optimization, all the platform and stuff. So he's a very great software developer. And so it was understandable that he went into like things that are already, you know, available, and you can play with them as a software developer, where you can don't need to invent the math for that. And he found your guys, basically. He found Hummingbot and was trying out like the grid trading ideas, some of the market trading ideas, the PureMM, and experimenting like how does it work. And I think after months of that, I recovered somewhat from our machine learning experiments. Yeah. And he came to me and said, look at that. I think that I won't disclose the strategies, but he found a situation in a combination of markets where your strategies in Hummingbot actually are profitable. Mm-hmm. And he showed it to me, and I'm like, okay, that makes sense. And we started applying it, and then I started seeing like the inefficiencies in that, and I started getting back into research. We improved like how do we model the spreads and stuff. But the general idea he just found just by clicking into Hummingbot and looking at markets. And then after that, we actually understood that like mass and trading, it's not for trading, it's for optimization. You come up with ideas that don't require mathematics most of the time. Mm-hmm. They are like, you can explain them with words and they are clear and understandable. Where you start requiring mathematics is when you want to execute them like in a not stupid way, like somewhat optimal. And finding that optimum requires math most of the time.
Cool.
Yeah.
So did you guys, are you guys using like the off the shelf Hummingbot strategies, or did you kind of, you know, customize your own?
We started using the off-the-shelves one. We traded PureMM for a while. Well, we fiddled with parameters, obviously. Then we started to want to model differently the mid price. So there is an opportunity. So we still use the Hummingbot, and there is an opportunity to extend some parameters in it with like external files. So we coded a Python script like with our own math and remodeled the mid price, but then traded Hummingbot around it with Hummingbot's parameters. Then we started to want to go higher frequency because the off-the-shelf one gives you 1 second updates. Yeah. And for some things it works fine, for some things you want to be faster. The first one I think we contacted your team and asked for the source code and like where is the parameters to go faster than 1 second.
Yeah,
so we fiddled with that for a while. And then we found like the strategies we started using started to like, you know, like being a bit different from what Hummingbot provides. We started to need like hedging on third-party exchanges, to take into account like rebates and like the typical spreads between the price. So it became complicated. And when you get complicated, you don't have much choice except to go custom. So we started building a lot of our own infrastructure around it. We still use it for some stuff.
Great.
For us.
Overall, we see a lot of professional training firms who've already built their own stacks, or it's hard for them to use it because it's more, you know, basic. But one thing we're planning to do is to kind of try to make it more, you know, customizable for these kind of use cases. So whether it's faster or more exchanges and whatever, overall, we're trying to make it more like more developer friendly. kind of like, you know, customizable.